a tax investigation. Very briefly, we say it is an in-depth. It is an in-depth examination. It's an in-depth examination by officers from Revenue Department. By officers from Revenue Department. To determine whether the taxpayer, determine whether the taxpayer has been compliant, has been tax compliant, determine whether the taxpayer has been tax compliant and it can be triggered, and it can be triggered by the following. And it can be triggered by the following. Number one. Failure to file returns. Failure to file returns within the due date. Another one. Non-payment of taxes. So if the taxpayer is not paying the taxes, it will trigger an investigation. Number three. Discrepancies. Discrepancies on the amount of taxes paid over period. Another one. Information from Registrar of Companies. Information from Registrar of Companies. The Registrar of Companies can inform KRA about your tax position. And the KRA can undertake a tax investigation. I'll give another one. Information from the competitors. We have information from employees. Information from customers, etc. They just say something. Tax evasion is an illegal way. Tax evasion is an illegal way of reducing tax liability. Tax evasion is an illegal way of reducing tax liability by contradicting the act. I.e. the taxpayer understates the income. The taxpayer understates the incomes and overstates the expenses. The taxpayer understates the incomes and overstates the expenses so as to minimize tax liability. so as to minimize tax liability. That's about overstatement of expenses and understatement of incomes. When expenses are many and the incomes is low, profit it kwa kidogo. Clear. But you understate the income so that it leads to a lower profit. The next point, tax avoidance. Tax avoidance is a legal way. Is a legal way of reducing tax liability. Is a legal way of reducing tax liability. By taking advantage of weaknesses in the act, by taking advantage of weaknesses in the act, so as to pay less taxes, so as to pay less taxes. We'll stop, continue by saying it is tax avoidance is a tax planning measure. Tax avoidance is a tax planning measure. Tax avoidance is a tax planning measure. There's a way of tax planning, planning for your taxes. The next point, tax fraud. Tax fraud. Is a situation where tax fraud is a situation where the taxpayer is a situation where the taxpayer fails to pay the correct amount of taxes. The taxpayer fails to pay the correct amount of taxes. As expected of him, as expected of him. What stuff can you say? The correct amount, continuation, the correct amount of tax may be reported as per the returns. The correct amount of tax may be reported as per the returns, but the taxpayer fails. But the taxpayer fails to pay it as required. But the taxpayer fails to pay it as required. Then you can skip one line and say, two methods are available under tax investigation. Two methods are available under tax investigation, i.e. number one, we have incomplete records. Incomplete records, and number two, capital statement. We have incomplete records and we have capital statement. Now, when I believe we all understand the concept of incomplete records, the debtor's control account, the creditor's control account, the prepayments and the accruals. Prepayments at the beginning we add or we less. Prepayments at the beginning we add, but of course, prepayments at the end we do it, we less. Accruals at the beginning we less, accruals at the end we add. Yeah. So, capital statement. Capital statement. Let me break it down. Let's just do that next week. Okay, I do for the whole weekend, the whole Sunday. So we talk about capital statements. So we say it is used to evaluate the taxable income. It is used to evaluate the taxable income of a taxpayer. It's used to evaluate the taxable income of a taxpayer who does not maintain proper books of accounts. Who does not maintain proper books of accounts? But has balances of assets and liabilities. But has balances of assets and liabilities. For several years, but has balances of assets and liabilities for several years. It is a talk about steps of preparing capital statements. Steps of preparing capital statements. So step number one, ascertain all assets of the taxpayer. Ascertain all assets of the taxpayer. Comma, both for business and private. Ascertain all assets of the taxpayer, both for business and private. Private pens are for personal. The private stock personal is okay. So tafuta assets zote za taxpayer. Number two, ascertain all liabilities of the taxpayer. Ascertain all liabilities of the taxpayer. Both for business and personal. So get all the assets, that is number one. Number two, get all the liabilities of the taxpayer, the biashara, as a personal, both for business and personal. Number three, determine the net assets. Determine the net assets by deducting total liabilities from total assets. By deducting total liabilities from total assets. Then step number four, determine the growth in net assets by deducting the net assets of a given year, from those of the previous year. So get the growth in net assets by just checking the change in net assets from one year to another. Negatively or positively. Continue by saying, this gives us the reported profit. This gives us the reported profit. So that growth in net assets is now the reported profit. or the net profit of that business. Now, from that net profit is when we come back to our language of taxation. We add back any disallowable expense, we less any non-taxable income, we less any allowable expense. So let's go to step number five. Add back any disallowable expense. Add back any disallowable expense, such as private expenses. In this topic, they're also called living expenses. I put into brackets living expenses. The expenses are amelipa stima nyumba yake, amelipa maji ya nyumba yake, the personal or the private expenses of that tax. Now remember, when you talk about the capital statement, in most cases, it's always used to determine the taxable income of an individual taxpayer. How are the small traders who come to you? The small traders who come to you, they don't maintain their books. But from 2015 to 2020, can you give me the list of your assets and liabilities? They'll comfortably give you because they write it somewhere. What were the transactions during those years that you can think about? KRA needs to get taxes from these people. But unfortunately, they don't have an income statement, they don't have a balance sheet. They cannot prepare a debtor's control account because they even don't have a bank statement. Payment is cash, receipt is cash. And end up wholesale mahali and end up with that kind of a receipt on cash basis. At the end of Kaduka Lake, Kataya and Dika check, it doesn't even have a bank account, right? So, anauza cash and ananua cash. But when you ask about what are your assets and what are your liabilities, both for business and private, he'll tell you I have a house somewhere, I have a motor vehicle somewhere, I have furniture, I have all those things. He can give you a summary of the assets and liabilities. And of course, he can also give you a few of the transactions that he undertook during the year. In complete records, we are looking at a taxpayer at least who has a bank statement. Because from the bank statement, we get the transactions during the year, and from his own records, we get the assets and liabilities and assets, so that we can do the debtors control account to get the credit sales, creditors control account to get the credit purchases. But the capital statement, we're looking at now that other taxpayer who is worse off than this person that has a bank statement. For now, we have them in our villages, we have them in the estates that we stay. They don't have a bank account. They have maybe their transactions currently in M-Pesa sasa. Pay bill, kamali batika wakapata. So that is what we are referring to here. KRA needs some tax from these people. How does it reach there? Get the all assets of this person, get all liabilities of this person, deduct to get the net assets, and find out they may grow by what, by how much from year in, from one year to another. So that growth, let it represent the net profit of that business. Then now adjust according. So you add back the disallowable expenses, such like the private expenses, there is the living expenses, comma, depreciation, provisions, except specific provision for bad debts. Provisions except specific provision for bad debts. Loss on disposal of assets, etc. Loss on disposal of assets, etc. Number next, step number six. Number six, right? Deduct all allowable expenses. Deduct all allowable expenses. E.g. capital allowances. Interest on loan. interest on loan, comma, donations, charitable institutions, etc. Donations to charitable institutions, etc. And finally, deduct all non-taxable incomes. Deduct all non-taxable incomes e.g. gain on disposal of assets. Gain on disposal of assets. Inheritance. When you get inheritance, an income is not a taxable income. Dowry payments. Just highlighting key items in the exam known as beta contiani, etc. So you can put the first purpose. See what we can do. For the same topic. November 2017 for me. Actually, I can read the money. It's a chihuahua. Yeah, it's the same. So let's handle that one. The question in a competition. Hakuna. So November 2017 question for me. Or the name used in the question. Peter Chihuahua. So question for me. By the way, when somebody public finance it on your syllabus, but examiner can give you a question like look at question one, question 4A. The question on public finance, but is again an application question. When you're being asked to discuss three measures that the central government could put in place to enhance financial accountability and transparency at the county level. The question on public finance, but is again, the examiner can test it and apply to emerging trends. The accountability at the county level is something that is really needed right now. Yeah. If somebody asks you a question like that one, and he gives you the 6 marks, and you say hallelujah. And you start saying, oh God. What are the measures that the central government can put in place to enhance financial accountability and transparency at the county level? Uh-huh. Keeping of records. Proper maintenance of records, and put it that way, yeah. Because records are there, but not proper maintenance. That is something that they can do, yeah. And they have brought in the aspect of increase, yeah. So enhancing the accountability and the accountability of the IFMIS system, yeah. IFMIS stands for it. It starts with I for information integrated Integrated? F looks like financial still. And M is management. And I? Thank you for measuring. I come up like yes. I love, of course, S in the system. That's how I do it. Integrated financial management and information system. Anyway, so if we can enhance that, we can ensure that it's really working for us. Yeah. What else can we do? What is the common ambassador national government can do? Yeah, instituting a strong internal control system. Even just make a simple thing by educating the officers, the revenue officers at the county level. Yeah. So you can, the national government can organize for seminars and workshops just to train them on how to be effective, right? What about enhancing heavy penalties? Yeah. So punish the offender so that if somebody thinks of making that crime, committing that crime, he knows the consequences are there, right? So some of these questions, you know, we that the pandemic is a theory of the taxation, most of them, they are more application. It's correct. Ensuring that skilled personnel are recruited at the county level. Yeah. You can ensure that you change the recruitment policies. Yeah. And even the process. Let's look at Peter Chawawa started a retail business on 1st January 2011. He has not been filing income tax returns for the 6 years to 31st December 2016. An investigation of his affairs revealed the following. The balance sheet of the retail business as at 1st December 2011 was as shown below. We have fixed assets to one our premises in assets here. Furniture and fittings, those are assets. Motor vehicles, the assets, current assets, you have the stock, debtors, and bank balance, and of course, you have cash in hand. That gives us the total assets there. Capital, net profit for the year, drawings, you have the mortgage loan, and the creditors. He constructed an extension to the premises in the year 2015 at a cost of $525,000. Extension to premises, that one is a fixed asset. That is a fixed asset. The following account balances were outstanding in the respective years as shown below. So information in note number one is about 2011. Note number three, 2012 to 2016. We have 2011 in note number one. In note number three, we have assets and liabilities from 2012 to 2016. We have the trade debtors, bank balance, trade creditors, cash in hand, and stock. Bank balance, so trade creditors and liabilities. And on a bank balance, take on a bank overdraft in 2016, a negative of 32,000. He withdrew goods worth 5,000 per annum from the business for his personal use. His drawings are allowable. Drawings is disallowable, so he should add back the drawings of goods. The principal repayment on each mortgage loan amounted to 50,000 per annum from that 1st December 2012. The mortgage interest paid in each of the 4 years ended that 1st December 2012, 13, 14, and 15 amounted to 175, 50, and 25 respectively. So mortgage loan in ongezeka. Interest is an expense. Interest is an expense. His wife opened a savings account in a commercial bank in the year 2012. The balances in this account are credited. After crediting the interest earned were as follows. So you have savings account and you have interest earned. Savings account, is it an asset? It's an asset, right? It's only bank account. You can consider it as an asset. What about the interest earned? Interest is an income. We earned. No. Interest earned is an income. That's the only taxable income. Remember, under the qualifying and non-qualifying interest, interest earned by an individual, qualifying or non-qualifying, you're doing consolidation. You do consolidation as a dividend and interest, qualifying, exempt, non-qualifying. It is? It's qualifying, thank you. Interest earned by individuals only. From financial institutions, the 15% withholding tax is final, no further taxation. But interest earned by companies from financial institutions, then that interest is non-qualifying. So the interest earned by body corporates from financial institutions non-qualifying. 15% withholding tax not final. But if it's individuals earning the interest, then that interest will have what? Qualifying interest, 15% is final, no further taxation. When you're here, down on my back. The living expenses in WTA were agreed with the revenue authorities as follows. Living expenses in it's allowable, only private expenses, right? And of course, WTA is allowable expenses. For 14 months, compute the annual taxable income of Peter Chawawa from 2012 to 2016. The questions for the factual statement are the questions that are widely marked in a very easy way. Every step has marks. So much for the people, and I can add. Peter Chawawa, 2012 to 2016, taxable income. So 2012 to 2016 taxable income computation. So we start with the year of 2012. We have the year 2011, 2012, 2013, 2014, 2015, and 2016. They can put the figures in thousands of shillings. So we start with 2011. In note number one, worker assets started at 2011. We have premises. So put there the premises. The premises in 2011, I think 2000. We have furniture meetings. Furniture and fittings in 2011, I think 1,000. Took on a motor vehicles. So motor vehicles, 500. We have the stock. stock of 2011, I think 250. We have data. Data 160. We have bank. Bank balance 81. And we have cash. Cash in hand of 9. We have all those assets of 2011. Then you can skip some two lines or three. Then you look at the data. So Hapawaita assets. You're looking for the assets. Then you look for the liabilities. Just skip some two lines in case there is any other asset that was not part of those. Some two or three lines. Then you put the liabilities. Liabilities, you can see have a mortgage loan. A mortgage loan. Mortgage loan in 2011, an amount of how much? 1,000. 1,000. We have creditors. Creditors, the 200. 200. I think under note number one, we've taken care of all assets and liabilities that are there. You're too much up on the capital, but we don't need the capital. Now, note number two, we have extension. So we constructed an extension, so we can have our assets, extension, in which year? The 2015. So end of 2015, worker extension, the cost of the extension was 625. 625 in 2015. Number three, the foreign account balances were outstanding in the respective years as shown below. Trade debtors, 2012-173. Debtors were happy. So 2012-173. 2013, is it 190, 2014-208, 2015-213.5, then 2016-253. Bank balance, we have 109, bank 109, 194, 281, 49.5, and finally, we have a negative of 32. We can put it here, make a negative. We either put it here, or to leave it under liabilities. Yeah, either put it there as a negative, or to return half of, we let it put it under liabilities. So it's a bank overdraft, it's a negative. Then after that, we have what? We have creditors. Creditors for Bapachini in 2012, we have creditors of 230. 2013, 241. 253. 253, 2014, 272. And finally, 291.5. Cash in hand, we have 10, per commission. So 10, 10, 10, 10, and 10. The extension was not there in 2011, back in 2014. We have the stock. Stock is going up at you. 2012 is 255. 2013, 302.5. 2014, 332.5. 2015, 366.
Electrical engineer 4, 2.5.
So number 4 is about drawings of goods. Number 5 is about how the mortgage was being paid. So not number 5. The principal repayment on each mortgage loan amounted to 250 per annum from 2012. So come on to deliver 250. Deliver your mortgage in 2012. $750 still. You can deliver 250 in 2013. How about Shanga? I think 500. Yeah. You can deliver 250 in 2014. How about Shanga? 250. Yeah. Yeah. So we are paying 250 each year from 2012, 13, 14, and 2015. And in 2015, only paid 250, we remained with nothing. 2015, it was not there. So to a savings account, savings account, that is an asset. A savings account. In 2011, I poor. 2012, we have 300. We have 900 in 2013, 100 in 2014, 725, and finally 750. I think that is it. So can we have the total assets? Total assets, then you can have total liabilities. Now, one thing, the extension. The extension of 625. The savings account are paid on that 750. The extension of the in the extension of 2015, 2016 is equal. 2016, this extension was here of 625. Now, the premises, they were there in 2011. So all assets that were there in 2011 and have not been accounted for under additional information, appreciate that they're still there up to 2016 as they are. So like premises, the 2000 work up at 2012, 2000 in 2013, 2000 2014, 2000 2015, and 2000 in 2016. Furniture and fittings, it was 1,000. Worker 1,000 kilometers. Motor vehicles is 500, so 500 in each of the years. By comparing? For tax purposes, the income that my wife gets belongs to me, apart from only three. My wife is responsible for paying tax on only three types of her income: her employment income at arm's length. Arm's length means the husband did not have any hand in her getting that income. If you are employed, you're not employed in a company where your husband controls more than 12.5%. But when he controls more than 12.5%, then he has some significant influence. Clear. You're not employed in a partnership where your husband is also a partner. Right? In short, your employer is not your husband. Then your employment income is at arm's length. So upon an income statement peke yake ambazo ni zake. Ya kwanza ni employment income at arm's length. Ya pili ni business income. Leo kwa wakati mwingine tunaitaga self-employment income. She runs a saloon somewhere and again is at arm's length. She is not in partnership with her husband. So she has a saloon somewhere. Maybe she has a butcher somewhere, whichever the business, as long as it is hers, not in partnership with her husband. The husband did not contribute any capital to that. Kama nikwenda KWFT, alienda akapewa loan, akaanzisha biashara. So employment income at arm's length, business income or self-employment, and professional income. Is okay. Any other income that my wife gets, for tax purposes, they belong to me. That's my savings account, that's an investment income. So the interest from the savings account, being an investment income, belongs to the husband for accountability as far as taxation is concerned. Employment income, self-employment income, from business income, and professional income. Professional income. So my wife did accounts, did CPA, and she decided to set up a tax consultancy firm. I'm an audit firm. She'll get some professional fees there, from there. As long as that professional income is not earned courtesy of partnership between her and the husband. So it must be a good arm's length. That's only the three. Any other income, she has some rental houses, your rental income, I'm saying, for tax purposes. I manage she calls sleeper file returns. I'm also sleeper taxes. Sleeper too. Like you know, you're more Russia. The first person that Karen looks for is your husband. That's how. But the scenarios where Karen exempts the husband, where he cannot be traced. You cannot start following somebody that you cannot trace. Yeah. Where the wife is the sole breadwinner of the family. You cannot start worrying somebody who does not even have the capacity to provide the house. Yeah. And the wife, because of the love to the husband, can decide to write to Kiara and tell Kiara, please, my incomes belong to me. Achana na mke wangu. Kiara will comply. So when she requests Kiara in writing to be assessed on all her incomes instead of the husband. When the husband decides to become insane, sometimes I might decide to die. Or is when now, okay, let's be serious. Akikufa, then the wife has to take responsibility. That's why your savings it's not among the three incomes that belong to the wife. As long as the income is coming from the savings, then it's not coming from employment. Employment is talk about employer. So it shall be stated there, employment income. The source of it. That one now shall be digging deeper. Shall be digging deeper. Because somebody else can argue naseme, that savings account is not an asset. You can say it's an investment. So that out of the investment, we get the interest, which is now the investment income. Yeah. Just the same way somebody else can say, when I have a bank balance, then it's an investment. And out of that investment of the bank balance, I'm getting the investment income, which is the interest on bank savings. So arguments can arise, but let's have it as an asset. Assets of 2011. Okay. 4,000, 4347, 2013, 1.5, 2014, 4431.5, 2015, 5866, finally, 5508.5. So liabilities up to 1200, up and up B. 980, up and 741, this one is 503, 272, and 291.5. Then you would have put it here for the savings account. You don't need the investment, you need the assets and liabilities. Assets and liabilities. Hi, can we get the net assets? Net assets. If the total assets, you can call them A, and total liabilities, we call them B. The net assets is A minus what? A minus B. So in 2011, what is A minus B? 4,000 minus 1,200. 2.3, 4.7, minus 9.80, 3367, 2013, 15, 9.85, minus 7.41, 435.5, 2014, 39, 38.5, 2015, 55.94, finally, 52.7. Can we get growth in net assets? So growth in net assets. So you ask yourself, from 2011 to 2012, the net assets have changed by how much? So take the net assets of 2012 minus for 2011. $567 net. From 2012 to 2013. $988.5. From 2013 to 2014, I'm seeing a negative. $427. 1565.5, and finally 2016 minus 2015, 377. It's a negative 377. So here we now represent reported profit. So add back any disallowable expense, deduct any allowable expense and any non-taxable income. la formalización en esos 14 months. So, we had drawings. Can we add back drawings? So, add drawings. Add back drawings to how much? Per annum 5,000 still. So, 5, 5, 5, 5, and 5. We are no longer interested in 2011. 2011 was just meant to help us know whatever the growth is for 2012. From 2012 to 2016. So 2011 is there as a working. Then number four is about the principal repayment of the mortgage loan. Can you list the mortgage in the interest on mortgage? So less mortgage interest. Mortgage interest, how much in 2012? Missing 100 in 2012. 2013 is what? 75. 2014? Christian, finally? 25. We have the savings account, interest earned. When you qualify, no further taxation. We add living expenses. So add the living expenses. 2012 is 300. 2013 is 400. 2014 is 450. 2015 is 500. And 2016 is 600. Then we less what? The capital allowances, the WTA, 155.5, 130.5, 109, 73, and how much? 157. And we are done. That gives us taxable income. So get for 2012, 2013, 14, 20, you have 567 plus 5 minus 100 plus 300 WTA we are less in. WTA we are less in. So that is it for such kind of question. We have the taxable income there. Kuna zile zenye kuna losses na kuna kuna profit. 2012 we're having a positive 16.5. So in 2014 is a negative. So 2014 is a loss, right? That is it. You're supposed to pay taxes on that income. Where there is a loss, you don't pay tax on losses. That loss is carried forward. The interest earned, it's an individual earning that interest. So no further taxation after the withholding tax. Lakini kama zingekuwa dividends, then hata hapo chini, kwa hiyo taxable income, tungeongeza hapa. Yes, hata tungekatoa hapa juu before this, dividend income, dividends from a cooperative society. Another example. It's an individual. For individual, the only non-qualifying investment income are the dividends received from a cooperative society other than the staff. Now, if we get another question of the same, this we have two for others and three for others. Let's look at that question five. Have an opportunity, it's there. So question five of the same sitting, say something on the CGT. CGT is what now? Capital gain tax. Just write for me, capital gain tax. Capital gain tax, CGT. We say it is tax paid on gain on disposal. It's tax paid on gain on disposal of assets. On gain of disposal, gain on disposal of assets, e.g. property. And securities. Property and securities. Full stop. It is charged at the rate of 5%. It is charged at the rate of 5% on the capital gain. It is charged at the rate of 5% on the capital gain. So 5% on the capital gain. So we look at question 5A. Still November 2017, question 5A. November 2017, 5A. So we are told that Mawenda Property Developers Limited purchased a residential house on 1st January 2015. Through a 12% per annum mortgage loan of shillings 4 million. So they took a mortgage and purchased a house. So because this mortgage was made for investment, so even the interest on mortgage should form part of the investment. It's part of the cost you're paying for that house. The company incurred the following expenses in obtaining the loan: mortgage fees, that's an incidental cost. An incidental cost that we have to account for, right? Valuation of the house, an incidental, we must account for it. Legal fees for conveyance, so incidental, we have to account for it. Clear. Additional information, the company replaced all doors in the residential house with metallic doors at a cost of 96,000. So the doors that were replaced, that is a capital expenditure. It is adding the value of the house, right? It's an addition to the value of the house. On 31st December 2016, the company sold the house at a price of 8 million after incurring the following expenses. So we incur the expenses, repairs of the house, 17,000. Repairs, lazima tu capitalize. Tumeuza tukapata 8 million. Lakini sikuna cost to incur. So we need the expenses, all the costs relating to that house, subtracted from the revenue that we got from its disposal. The difference is the gain on disposal. And the cost starts from when we purchase this house up to when we are selling this house. Any repairs that we undertook, there's an expense that we must account for, right? Any maintenance, any advertisement that you're making, the agent's commission, valuation fees, and the legal fees, total expenses to live here. Ambazo lazima to recover from the revenues that you are making out of the sale of this house. So that the difference now becomes the gain on disposal. And that's why for 6 months, when I can compute the capital gain or loss arising from the sale of the above house. So first things first, let us get the total cost. Total costs. So we have the acquisition. Acquisition cost. The cost of acquiring the property was how much? I think 4 million. 4 million, clear. Then we add incidental costs. Incidental costs. We can put here the loan interest. The loan interest is 12% per annum. Unfortunately, we don't know for how many years. We can account for 1 year. 12% of 4 million. 380. 480. That's what's going to 480. You're going to audit fees. 48,400. We have valuation. Valuation of the house and amount of 100 lot. 120,000. We have legal conveyance fees. An amount of 80,000. We also put metallic doors. We put metallic doors at a cost of 96,000. For note number two, it's going to add the costs. But upon the cost, ya kwanza. So the total cost, this one is also called transfer value. How much is that? 24,400. Then after the transfer value, we add other costs. Have other incidental costs. So other incidental costs. We have the preparers of the house, right? Preparers of the house, 78,000. To go on advertisement. Advertisement 24,200. We have the agent's commission. Agent's commission 12,000. Took on evaluation. Evaluation fee of 148,000, and we have the legal fees. 42,800. And now that gives us the net cost. Sometimes it's called adjusted cost. Let's use the legal term, adjusted cost. So adjusted cost is how much? So you add the 48.4 plus that one. 51, 39, 5129, 400. Like that. So 1 million. 1 million, sorry. 500. 5129, 400. So we therefore have sales proceeds. We sold it at how much? At 8 million. 8 million. Then less adjusted cost. The adjusted cost is 5129,400. So the difference is the capital gain. So the capital gain is of how much? 58,7600. That is it. Then you can get the CGT, the tax, although it was not asked in the question, but it's good to just, because you are in class, just say capital gain tax equals 5% of that. The capital gain tax, 5% of 28,7600. Let's try Chambwaring one. If we're okay with it, then we go to something else. Consider almost, I think, the last sitting of our past paper. That is November 2015, question 5C. Vamos aquí, Dad. Estamos aquí de Samuel, acá hay Daniel, y así, vamos aquí. So let's analyze it, you see, if you're okay with it, then you do something else. Now, Amos abused this man, so that is November 2015, question 5C. So Amos Akida, a useless man, is facing a tax investigation by the revenue authority, which suspects that he has been under declaring income for the 4 years from 2011 to 2014. With the head of a team from the revenue authority conducting an investigation on Amos, he has submitted to your team reports of his private and business assets and liabilities from January 2011 to 2014 December, as shown below. So you have the assets and liabilities, January back to December. Factory premises, any assets? Those are assets. Plant and machinery, any? Motor vehicles, are they assets? Inventory, receivables, not any assets. Leo, what of the private residence? November 2017, question 5B. Private residence, any assets? These are all assets, both for business and private. Leo. So private residence, that those are assets, trade payables, the liabilities. Get end up liabilities. Bank loan, the liability, loan from a friend, still a liability. Mortgage loan, the liability in cash balance. Cash balance is an asset, clear. The number one, the cash balance on that first December 2012 included 60,000 inherited from a relative on 30th August 2012. So inheritance, it's willes. Inheritance willes. Pick up a list of the mission, which is clear. So he lists the non-taxable income, inheritance. His living expenses for each of the 4 years were as follows. Living expenses in disallowable. So he adds back the living expenses, right? Interest on mortgage at the rate of 15% per annum. The interest on mortgage is some of the deduct as allowable expense. Leo. So just take like now, 2020. So for 2011, you simply do 15% of each of the mortgage balances that you have. 2011, chapter 15% yake. Yeah, 2012, chapter 15% yake. 2013, and 2014. Achana na 2010. 2010 in the subject of, sorry, 1st January 2011, senior 2010. Because 2011 is the 1st January and that 1st December still. 1st January, the upside of part of the growth. After getting the growth in net assets, the 1st January 2011, we ignore. Still. Then the mortgage interest, just concentrate on the mortgage as at the end of 2012, 2013, and 2014. Then there are no disposals of non-current assets during the period under investigation. Taxable income of Amos Akida for each of the 4 years, 2011, 12, 13, and 14, ignore capital allowances. Is it manageable? Yeah, there's a kind of skill. That one is okay. Those are the ones that are always the quick questions that you simply get the answers and move on. That you get the answers to Nasonga Bene. Now, I want to say something on taxation of leasing entities. Taxation of leasing entities. It was 2011, November 2015, question 5C. November 2015, question 5, the last page of our paper. So taxation of leasing entities. So we say, leasing entities rent out assets to the lessee, rent out assets to the lessee with the promise of paying the periodic lease rentals. The promise of paying the periodic lease rentals. Full stop. The Act provides for the following provisions. The Act provides for the following provisions under leases. The Act provides for the following provisions under leases. Number one, lease rentals are allowable expenses. Lease rentals are allowable expenses in the books of the lessor, in the books of the lessee. Lease rentals are allowable expenses in the books of the lessee. Number two, lease rentals are taxable incomes. Lease rentals are taxable incomes in the books of the lessee, the lessor. So lease rentals are taxable incomes in the books of the lessor. Number three. The leased assets. The leased assets are capitalized in the books of the lessor. The leased assets are capitalized in the books of the lessor. Spelling to him. Lesson of a lesson and imagine. Is it like that? You should have a tongue cheap. I can eat from me. And ready to put out. Can I get it? So similar, some lesson. Hi. The lessor or lessor claims capital allowances. Claims capital allowances on the leased assets. Claims capital allowances on the leased assets. So talk about types of leases. Types of leases. Number one, we have operating lease. Operating lease. Let me say, it is a lease where the asset is transferred to the lessee. The asset is transferred to the lessee. But all benefits and costs remains. But all benefits and costs remains with the lessor. But all benefits and costs remain with the lessor. Second one, finance lease. Finance lease. You say it is similar. It is similar to operating lease. It is similar to operating lease. Except that some risks are transferred to the lessee, comma, mostly maintenance costs. So maintenance costs are mostly transferred to the lessee. But the reward is not back to one, so suddenly for the lease rentals. Actually, the maintenance of that leased asset in most cases are transferred to the lessee. Number three, cross-border lease. The finance lease. We don't have the specific examples, but an explanation of what it is. Like I lease out my car to maybe these easy car hire companies. So it's upon the car hire companies to ensure that the maintenance of that car is always enhanced. That's the finance lease. The rewards are with the lessor, but some of the risks relating to that car are transferred to the user, the lessee. But an operating lease is where, when I take that car and transfer to this hiring company, it can become an official itengeneze nimpe kwa mzuri. So all the risks and rewards remain with the lessor. But the lessee only uses that asset and pays the rest, the lease rentals. So it's all about the risks and rewards. That's what differentiates the operating lease from the finance lease. So cross-border lease, what's the cross-border lease? The lease that crosses the border. It's true. So it is a lease where one party, comma, either the lessee or lessor, is in Kenya and the other person, is in another country outside Kenya, Then finally talk about higher purchase lists. Say, it is a lease agreement. With an option. It's a lease agreement with an option of acquiring that asset. An option of acquiring that asset upon its expiry. Full stop, next point. The lessee pays a deposit. Pays the deposit in higher purchase installments over a given period. After which, the asset will be transferred to the lessee. After which the asset will be transferred to the lessee. So let's just highlight some few notes on the higher purchase so that when you come, higher purchase was tested last sitting. So when you come back after a short break, you can do a question on higher purchase. So, but let's put down some of the context relating to it. Next point to say this. It involves determination of two major components. I.e., number one, unrealized profit, that is the UPS. And number two, gain/loss on repossession. Then you skip one line and you say, the higher purchase price, that is the HP price, which in the layman's language is now the selling price, equals to, we take the deposit plus total installments. So that will represent ourselves. Tumeuza hiyo asset na pesa ngapi? Ile deposit ulilipa plus ile installments zote ambazo ulilipa. So we just talk about UPS equals Talk about receivables over sales times the profit. Receivables over sales times the profit. Then, of course, receivables. How debtors amount for now is simply the sales the sales that we made minus the receipts that we got. Tuliuza ngapi ya tumereceive ngapi? Difference ni madeni yenye bado ya kuje. Sales minus receipts that gives us the receivables. And UPS is the receivables, so the profit that was never realized. The receivables against our sales times the profit. So what percentage of our sales represent the debtors? Now, maybe we just have a goods repossessed account. Let me prepare. Let's talk about goods repossessed account. So goods repossessed account. So this account will be debited with receivables. Will be debited with receivables. Will be credited with the UPS and realized profit on goods repossessed. Will also be credited by revaluation. Those goods repossessed were valued by how much? So you have the receivables, the unrealized profits, the revaluation, and of course now the balancing figure, kama ipoku, inakuwa gain on repossession. Gain on repossession, it's only the balancing figure. The balancing figure is on the debit side. If it's on the credit side, then we have loss on repossession. So let's have a small breather. Break the kangaroo. Let's look at the question on hire purchase. It was tested last meeting. In question 3B. Before last meeting, it was a test. Before last meeting, hire purchase can never be tested. Now, question 3B of November, of November, September 2021. Now the following information was presented. The following information was presented to you by the management of Credit Lenders Limited as at the 1st December 2020. The company deals in the sale of manufacturing machines on hire purchase terms. So this is a company that sells on hire purchase terms. Remember the hire purchase lease. You are taking up this asset, you'll pay the deposit, and you'll also pay the installment. But that is when now the asset is transferred to you. Now you own the asset after that. So it's a lease agreement that has the right to transfer those assets to the lessee upon payment of the deposit and the hire purchase installments. Now the company purchases the machines at 600,000 each. So each machine costs 600,000. The hire purchase price per unit comprises of a deposit of 160,000 and 88 quarterly installments of shillings 80,000. Cash price per unit is 700,000. So you're not selling on cash, We are selling on hand purchase, so the cash price to us Mikelele. During the year ended the 1st December 2020, the company sold 4080 manufacturing machines, of which collections of 569,600,000 were received at the year end. During the year, the company repossessed 80 machines. So the net sales are 4,000, right? Out of the 80 machines were repossessed, which had been sold earlier in the year. The customer had already paid 6.4 million on the units, which was included in the total cash collection for the year. The repossessed units were valued at 520,000 each at the year end. Expenses incurred in the course of the year included rent expenses. Yes, any allowable expense? Rent expenses allowable. Legal expenses, are they allowable? 1.2, of which 320,000 was in respect of defense against illegal importation of a machine. Is that an allowable or disallowable? Any disallowable. Advertising and marketing, is it allowable?
Why is it allowable?
Because it's a crime. It's a crime. Ulifanya makosa, alafu najitetea. So the legal expenses relating to mistakes can never be allowed. The mistakes that you committed, you could have avoided those mistakes to avoid that expense. So salaries and management expenses, are they allowable? Purchase of mobile forklift? We give it WTA at the rate of 5%. Other incomes included royalties, net of withholding tax. Such a taxable income? Royalties should go to other incomes, Leo, as a taxable income, true. But it is net of withholding tax, get the gross royalties, less any expense if there is. You get the net royalties, we tax, then you give the withholding tax relief. The dividends from Uzima Cooperative Society, net of withholding tax, taxable. Qualifying or non-qualifying? Non-qualifying, thank you. Then the revenue authority has reached an agreement with the company whereby profits for tax purposes will be determined on the basis of proportionate cash collected from the customers for this year, for the year sales, for 12 months taxable profit or loss for that year. Taxable profit or loss for that year. Aye. So let's say this. So you're looking at, first of all, when you look at that question, the normal income statement, you have the sales, will less the expenses. The sales are what we got from the higher purchase, the sale of the items from the higher purchase. Expenses, you have the cost, the purchases, you know, the cost of sales basically, and you also less other expenses relating to the business. So now, start by saying that HP price, higher purchase price equals deposit plus what? Total installments. Deposit plus total installments. We have the deposit of how much? I think 160,000. And the installments of how much? How many installments? 8 installments of 80,000 each, right? What is the selling price? $800,000. So selling price here too. And that is the selling price for each machine. For each machine. We have the purchase price. The assets are purchased at how much? The purchase price is $600,000. Right? We have the You need storage. The company sold how many units? 48. But out of the 48, how many units were possessed? 20 possessed 80 units. So that's just a breakdown of what the question is all about. So we have our selling price, we have the purchase price, we have the quantity. And out of the quantity, we sold 48 units. Unfortunately, out of the 48 units, kuna zile ambazo tulipossess because our customers mainly failed to pay the installment. Our purchase wana repossess sana still. Na fail kulipa labda installment mbili, so goods na kuchiwa. The terms, the terms. Installment. The only challenge is that they don't care whether you are doing well or doing bad. So deliver the installments within the due time, within the agreed time. Maybe they can give you 1 month. The following month they're not doing the necessary. They come and repossess the goods without giving you anything. And I come back shame with money. Yeah. I come back shame with money. Now, let's get the UPS. Unrealized profit equals what? Receivables divided by what? Receivables divided by sales. Then you multiply by what? You multiply by the profit. And we know that receivables equals to sales minus what? The sales that we made minus the cash that we received. The balance is what is still outside with our customers. So sales minus receipts. Just get the two types of UPS, the UPS on the net sales and the UPS on goods repossessed. So let's start with the next steps. Let's start with the next steps. So our next steps, how many are the next steps? This 4,000 units. And each unit has a selling price of how much? 800,000. How much is that? $3.2 billion. Like that. $3.2 times 10 raised to 4 something. Now, $3.2 billion, right? So those are the sales. Can we get the receipts? So that we get our receivables. The total receipts is because of the Sangha. 569 So the total receipts are 569,600,000, right? Out of the 569,600,000, kuna ile ambayo relate to the repossessed goods. Of how much? I think 6.4. We need the receipts relating to goods that were not repossessed. The 6.4 is included in the net receipts, the total receipts for the year. Clear? So, two are the 6.4 million. Now, back in Angaka. $563,200. Did that? So kwa hivyo, how receivables were kuanga? 636, 800. 800,000. So therefore, are we in a position to get the UPS? The UPS. Receivables per quarter is 26. 36,800. Divide by sales is a gap. 3.2. Can we get the profit? What is the profit per unit? The profit per unit, the cost is 600,000, the selling price is 800,000, so the profit is 200,000. Clear. How many units are you looking at? You're looking at 4,000 units with a profit of 200,000. So can you get the UPS? Mm-hmm. UPS of how much? 659, 659. 200,000. 659,200,000. That is the repossessed on net sales. The UPS on net sales. You also need to get the UPS on goods repossessed. The UPS on goods repossessed. We need to get the receivables on goods repossessed divided by the sales times the profit. Let's have goods repossessed. So this one you can have it as number A, number B, goods repossessed. Sorry, repossessed goods. Repossessed goods. How many are the repossessed goods? Sales target? We're having 80 units. Thanks how much? That's 800,000. That is how much? 6.4 million. 64 million. Still. Then we less what? We less than 6. How much are the receipts relating to those goods? 6.4 million. So the 6.4 million. Kwa hivyo, receivables yake iko ngapi? How much? 57.6 million, right? So can we get its UPS? UPS yake inakuja ngapi? The receivables ambazo ni 57,600 divided by the total sales. Total sales is 64 million times the profit. How many units? Is it 8 units? And the profit per unit was how much? 200,000. much. What are you going for, medium? So the two key items, the two key components to talk about, we need the UPS and we need the gain or loss on disposal. UPS already to now on the next sales, which is the UPS on next sales equal 659,200,000, and the UPS on the goods repossessed 14.4 million. So those are the first components that we need to talk about as far as car purchase is concerned. The two key components, the unrealized profit, and the second one is the gain or loss on repossession. The UPS, you always have the two types of UPS, one on the net sales and the second one on goods repossessed. Would I let profit and how had they realized? Let's talk about goods repossessed account and have it as number C. Goods repossessed account. So goods repossessed account, ikona ni yake. Do you have receivables relating to goods repossessed? The receivables relating to goods repossessed? How much were they? The 57.6. Yeah. The receivables, let me put it in thousands of shillings. So 57,600, right? That is about the receivables. We have the UPS. UPS, yeah, can you get? 14.4. So 14,400. We have revaluation. The goods repossessed were revalued at how much? They were revalued at how much for per unit? I think 520,000. How many units a day? So 80 units takes 520,000. 520 times 80. How much? 34. 49,600. 41,600. Gain or loss on repossession? This is 56 and this is 57. Yeah. They have loss on repossession. The balancing figure? 1600. We have the 1600 there, right? So it's all working with the company. Then now I can prepare the income statement. Onajita Credit Lenders Limited. Credit Lenders Limited. Is it 2020? 2020. Taxable income. Computation. 2020 taxable income computation. Now the normal income statement. We start with what? We start with the revenue. How much sales? We sold 48 units, and each unit was being sold at how much? 800,000. How much do you make out of that? $32,000. $264,000. Can we less the cost of sales? Less the cost of sales. We are looking at 48 units, and each unit was costing how much? 600. $34,000. So we have the gross profit. $816,000. The gross profit of $816,000. Come out to get one again on repossession. In the Kapakama, we add gain on repossession. But now we have a loss on repossession that will be an expense. Yeah. So therefore we less allowable expenses. We less allowable expenses. Let's start with the loss on repossession. So loss on repossession, it's 1600. So 1600. So UPS, you're also suffering. So UPS on net sales. And then less profits on net sales. The UPS on net sales was how much? It's 659,200. So 659. 200. Tulikuwa na ingine pia hapo ya ni goods repossessed. Kwa tulikuwa na UPS ya ni. So UPS on goods repossessed, which was 14,400, right? So 14,400. Alafu expenses zingine za kawaida sasa. Unamaliza swali. Tulikuwa na rent. Rent ya ngapi? Rent of 420. We have legal expenses. Legal expenses, 1200 minus what? The 1200 minus 320, how much is that? Sorry? 880. Advertising is near level. So advertising an amount of how much? 525. We also have salaries and management expenses. Salaries and management fees amount in quarter 819. We have WTA of forklift. It's 25%. So 25% of how much equal? 2.8 700. Because of the expenses that are there. So what is the total expense? Total expenses. 678. 678, 615. So 678, 615. So we get what? The total taxable, sorry, taxable business income. The difference, 816,000 minus that one, 137,385.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
137,385. So, alam mo na yata ni. Kung ako sa mga ada income, stay. So,
mention.
Ako na strong ko.
Pwede mo maging napapali.
Nakunat na pala, goja pali ako sa so, other income, we have royalties. They are net of withholding tax. If it's net, then kindly gross it up. With only tax and royalties are what left? What percent? 5. Royalties the 5%. Royalties the 5%. So therefore, we do 289,750.
Yes.
If that amount equals to 95%, what is that 100%? So 100 over 95 times 289. So 289.75. So the figure said in thousands of shillings. How much is that? 305. Now, come out with the expenses. Let's understand something here. Come out royalties in the expenses. Maybe the need, hiring of space, payment of the dancers. Maybe traveling, yeah. Royalties come out when I'm wasani, when I hire space. Maybe when I hire some dancers, they hire the instruments, salaries to the staff, to recognize, yeah. Come here, cannibal. So, after to get one at 305, they come here, come up, then we less. So, get the gross royalties, not the net. Then the gross royalties, we less allowable expenses. Yeah. Is also the hire of space, payment of the crew, maybe the role, the repairs and maintenance, if you have some instruments you're repairing and maintaining. So unfortunately, hapa hatuna, so that our net royalties becomes 300. So the net we mean the royalties less expenses. So the royalties less expenses. We have the dividends. Dividends from Uzima Corp. Dividends from Uzima Corp. Who are Mr. Net? Who are Mr. Net? Yeah. So if it is net, kindly gross it up. Gross it up. Dividends not only holding tax thing up. 15%. So can we take it back to 100%? So that is 100 over 85. That's the total dividends of how much? 120. That is how much? How much? 141. So can we have total taxable income? That one plus the two, one, 137-831. What if you are asked to get the tax liability, although it was not asked? You do what? The 25%. But when a tax liability has been 3 months, sababu tumetaka max mingi hapo na Mungu amesikia. Kwa total yake kuja 15. When you just do 25%, you're getting one mark. What about the remaining two? Thank you. The withholding tax return. Don't forget that. Mezangara, I finished what I started. So having 25% of 137,831. Then we less the withholding tax relief. The concept for the royalties, which is 5% of the gross 305. 5% of 305, 10.25, 15. So 15.25. Then we have dividends. 15% of 141. So 21.15. The difference. 2.15 will put it there. So the difference between the net and the gross. And when it's out, the 12.15 is coming from the cards here. Yeah. That's my mini card. But ideally speaking, the withholding tax is the difference between the gross and the net. So 141 minus 120. Just like this one, 308 minus 289.75. I might get the round off. The round off. That's why. That is it. So what is that area that makes you not sleep well? What is that area that makes you not sleep well? Let them also hear that. Those will hear the recording. So if he says that, start with the, use the gross profit method. Then he's simply telling you, start with the sales, less cost of sales, get the gross profit, you less allowable expenses. Use the net profit method. Net profit method. You start from the reported net profit, you add back the disallowable expenses, and you less the non-taxable incomes and allowable expenses that have not affected your profits. Yeah. Yeah, that is one reason as to why we start with either net profit or the gross profit. Number one, directions from the examiner. We try to najaribu kuti, we comply, otherwise he punishes us. When he says, start with the net profit. Alafu kwe kichwangu more than a gross profit. Trust you me, hata soma. That's the unfortunate bit. Hata soma chochote. It will simply give you zero for that specific question because you didn't follow instructions. So it's very important to follow instructions. When he says start from the gross profit, then kindly, jaribu takama upendi your method. Jaribu to me that method because examiner ame dictate. Like he dictate, tuna comply. Clear? Yeah. The other reason as to why we start with either, it depends with how the question is set up. When the question is set up in a manner that we don't have the net profit, then we cannot start with what we don't have. Right? Because you can get a question where we just pick from a summary, from a banner to the list of items. They've given us the list of incomes, they've given us the list of expenses, but they've not done the income statement. Then in such a case, I cannot start with the net profit because I don't have it, right? And in most cases, here you've got incomplete records. We have the assets, the liabilities, debtors control account, property sales, creditors control account, property purchases. Then cost of sales, you get it. Less the cost of sales from the sales, you get the gross profit, and you less allowable expenses. Yeah. Remember the prepayments and accruals. Prepayments at the beginning, you add. Prepayments at the end, you less. Accruals at the beginning, we do the opposite. Accruals, we less at the beginning, at the end, you add. So instructions from the examiner and the setup of the question gives us the direction on whether to use the gross profit or the net profit method. Insurance number part. Ceded, accepted, ceded the income or expense. I got some open as man of confidence. Exceeded. Now accepted. Accepted your expense. Exceeded the income. Yeah. Commission on reinsurance accepted. Gani. There is question 4B of Emenda Uko Nyuma, May 2016. So question 4B of May 2016, that is a question on insurance. Now, question 4 of May 2016. Question 4 of May 2016. What is the tax having? Kama parama. So when somebody asks you, evaluate four features that distinguish tax havens from other taxation regimes for 8 months. One of the features, you're trying to learn about some theory. We don't hate it. and area with
lower taxes.
So that's one. That's one of the. That's one of the distinguished. One of the feature.
So tax havens are associated with very minimum taxes or no taxes.
The tax havens are associated with very minimum taxes or no taxes. Cynthia. Yes. Which one?
This one.
They're statutory. They are countries, not just areas. They are countries. Is it other taxation regimes took on a lot of taxes to pay? Any other feature? Minimal disclosure.
Yes.
So minimal disclosure of tax information. Yes. Minimal disclosure of tax information of the taxpayer. They're not regulated, it's true. We shall make that as a third point. So there's a for tax havens, there's minimal disclosure of tax information. There's a lot of privacy and secrecy. That's why most of the African leaders will end up investing. Ili ukianza kuwafuatilia, sheria yao inasema very minimal disclosure. So their investments are more safe there. The number three, sumu mbesema gani? Mbesema point gani number three? In? Yes, sir. They're actually, with the tax havens, the regulation is not all that very high. So we can talk about minimal regulation. Minimal regulations. Minimal regulations. Hi. Tuangalia part B. So question 4B, May 2016. We are calling your name, 2016. Now, Salama Insurance Company Limited provides question 4B. Salama Insurance Company Limited provided the following financial records for the year ended at 1st December 2015. We have the gross premiums, premiums in insured income, reserves for unexpired risk. If there was a decrease in reserves, then it will be an income. If there is an increase in reserves, then it will be an expense. You come up with a deal in bad debts, specific bad debts. Increase is an expense, decrease is an income. So what happens if we have reserves on 1st January and there are no reserves on that 1st December? Did they decrease or did they increase? That means they decrease to zero. So that becomes a taxable income. Insurance premiums paid? Expense or income? Does an expense. Claims paid? Does an expense. And you have claims due. Claims due in accrual or prepayment? Due in accrual. So accrual at the beginning we add or less. At the beginning accrual we less paper. And at the end we do it. We add life assurance fund. We cannot mix the two. We cannot mix general insurance and life assurance. So they were separated. And how we tax the life assurance in life assurance business items in the amount transferred from the life fund for the benefit of the shareholders, and of course that excess management expenses and commission paid.
tuendelee tuone. Commission on reinsurance ceded. Income or expense ceded. Ambia neighbor seme ceded ni income. Commission ceded is an income. Commission accepted is what? It's an expense. So, ceded, you are receiving and you are receiving some commission for insuring another insurance company. You can have a small insurance company that is insured by a bigger insurance company. So you as a bigger insurance company insuring another insurance company will be paying some commission. So that commission you are being paid is what is commission on reinsurance ceded. Commission on reinsurance accepted is now you being insured by another insurance company. So you've accepted to pay. So that is an expense. Ceded an income, accepted an expense. Foreign exchange loss? Expense if what?
If realized.
Come on, if unrealized, we don't have to pay. But when you are silent, you can make an assumption either way. Yeah. If you assume realized, sinakwa allowable expense. Unrealized sinakwa is allowable expense. Rent income, other incomes, residential ama commercial.
Residential.
You make an assumption that makes your life easier. Purchase of computers. WTF what rate? Cost of computer software. Maintenance of 35%. Claims recovered on reinsurance. It's an income, still. Or you reduce your claims by the same amount. Agency expenses. Investment income. Management salaries. Repair of rented property. It's an expense of rental income, still. New sites. We are repairing the rented properties. So it can only be an expense of the rental income. The bank can actually do other expenses. It is an expense against the rental income.
We just offset it.
Yes, it reduces the rental income. And there are other expenses. So, new sign we give it WTA, the rate of? What of depreciation? Kelele. Legal expenses relating to claims? Is it an expense? Yes, it is an expense. It relates to claims. Let's just appreciate that the insurance. Yes, ile ya makosa. Lakini hapa hajasema kama ni makosa ulifanya. The crime will commit a mafanas. So let's allow it as an expense because it relates to claims. Rent and rents? That's an expense. The company operates both general insurance business and life insurance business in the same building where rent and rates are shared in the ratio of 3:3, respectively. Just a portion between the rent and rates for the general insurance. Agency expenses include general manager salary of 280 working in the life insurance business. So any expense here life. Strike for general. Investment income includes dividends of 114 net of tax from a subsidiary company. Dividends from a subsidiary company? Is it not qualifying? It is exempt. Atakama exempt itakatana qualifying. Where is it not qualifying with that? When you're not qualifying, then those dividends must be coming from a cooperative society other than SACOs. That is the only dividends that will affect us. Clear. Any other dividends, Nikelele? Says Nikelele.
and 78,400 from proceeds of sale of a car involved in an accident. Taxable, not taxable?
This one is an insurance company. Insurance company selling a car, selling exercise of subrogation rights.
Yeah. So yeah,
that's an income from exercise of subrogation rights. Their labors. The English word. It's a business law.
These are policies.
The rights that you have for the to the assets whose claim has already been paid. You are selling. When you are selling, you're not incurring an expense, you're getting an income. So income, you're allowable, money taxable. Thank you. Some allowable by income, then it would be numerous. Because an income is either what? Taxable or non-taxable. Now, gross premium includes sale of insurance policies to life insurance company amounting to 748,400. Premiums, the left driver general. The company constructed a commercial building with shops, offices, and showroom at a cost of 6.4 million on 1st January 2015. Rent income from the property amounted to 55,600 before deducting capital allowances and expenses amounting to 84,600. Support for rental income. You have the net rent, the gross rent, less the expenses. Hi. Umechora kichwa. Najita Salama. Salama Insurance Company. Salama Insurance Company Limited. 2015. Taxable income computation. So let's start with the general cover or the general insurance. So we start with the gross premiums. The gross premiums is a happy. So 14,890. Now, note number four. Can we less the premiums for life assurance? So we less life assurance premiums. So. What are you showing your artists? The way we are showing. You can even say 14,890 minus unapata the answer of company. So your life will come back. 748.4. So the gross premiums will happen. 141.6. Now, I always advise that kill two birds with one stone. Unacha space kidogo, incomes ukizipata unaziweka kwa incomes, expenses ukizipata unaweka kwa expenses, so that you go very fast with your answer. So sometimes you need to find a way of finishing within the 3 hours. Expenses not after incomes the gap panza. So you leave some little space up for you. Then after we less what? Allowable expenses. So it is allowable expenses. So among the allowable expenses and incomes, let's go one at a time. We start with additional information. The company operates for general insurance, business, and life insurance in the same building where rent and rates. So can we have rent and rates? Rent and rates for the general? 3/5 or 2/5? So 2/5 of how much? Of 760.4. Which isn't that big? How much? 384. 384? 304.16. So 304.16. Number two. Agency expenses include general manager salary of 80 working in life insurance business. Can we have agency expenses? Total expenses tangapi? 1380.7.
Yes.
So out of 1380.7 to 2200 what? 1280. Nabaki nangapi? 1100.7. Investment income, it and our other incomes. Gross premium to maintain NASO. The company constructed commercial building, only other incomes. I truly value you. Gross premium to maintain NASO. Reserves for unexpired risk. We have the balance on 1st January 2015. We have anything on that 1st December. So meaning we had the reserves in January, we didn't have any reserves in December. So we reduce them as we increase. We reduce to zero. So talk about decrease in reserves for an expired risk. Decrease in reserves for an expired risk. So tukianza mwaka zilikuwa 486, na tukifunga mwaka ni zero. So you're having 486. Reinsurance premiums paid. Expense or income?
Expense.
So reinsurance premiums paid or lipanga? 384. So 384 claims. So claims paid. My claims for the year. To deliver on that, 9364. Can someone click on a prepayment accrual? Accrual at the beginning we add or less. So it is how much? 670. And at the end, we have a pool of how much? So how much are the claims for the year? How much? 9494. So 9494. Life assurance funds, Nikelele. Commission seated. Life assurance fund. Life assurance policy. We have the general and we have life. So the balance of the life assurance, the deposits you have in the life assurance business. So seated niangapi? 760.8. and we have accepted. So commission accepted younger thing. 1940. Foreign exchange laws. Realized or unrealized? Where can realize Nika? Don't make a dash. You can realize to make a dash to make our life easier. Rent incomes and other incomes. Purchase of computers, can we give it WTA? So WTA on computers. Is it 25%? 25% of how much? 300. That is 75. Computer software. Software is 25% of 150. How much is that? That's 7.5. Claims recovered on reinsurance. Is that an income?
Yes.
Five sixty two point eight.
It's a very genuine question. Yeah. You know, there are some things that you do which your fate is left in the hands of the man. He may decide to punish you, or he may decide to give you the answer, the correct answers to whatever you did right. But because there's something that you did wrong, you'll not get all the marks in that question. So you may get some marks in the question. The biggest punishment is giving you a wrong. So we are betting. Anyway, let's finish this question. Claims recover to Shadil Nazo. Agency expenses to Shadil Nazo.
Yes.
Investment income, other incomes. Management salaries, Priyata Mahali. Bona mi unaruka yo. Imaliza. So management salaries, Nangati. 948.2.
Are you
waiting? 280 copy. Life assurance business. Repair of rented property to the other incomes. New signs can you have WTA?
Sure.
Oh, sure. I'm seeing a China. A stronghold vehicle marat. 10% of what? Is it 48? That is 4.8. Depreciation nikeleles. We have legal expenses on claims. company ya gap 4.8. The rent and rest tulikuwa tumemaliza, sio? So what is the allowable expenses and how much is the gross income? How much? Gross income. Mama Pachini. 40? 0.66. And you need 15? 15? 15,950. 15,950. 0.6. Huh? Open a subrogation somewhere. A subrogation somewhere. Sorry. Before this, to connect, where is it now? Note number three. Investment income includes dividends. And 17 from proceeds of sale of car. So sale of car involved in accident. In insurance terms, you're saying those are the proceeds from the exercise of subrogation rights. An amount of how much?
Okay,
I'm going to say that. 78.4. And you know, my time she was not there. I appreciate because of my margin of protest. Yeah. So therefore, I think that is it. So what is our gross income? It's an expense of rental income. It is other incomes. Syntax error. It's okay, uko. So the taxable business income becomes what? 20? other incomes to kona nini? Kona rental income. Rental income. Can you deal with the commercial building? Commercial building, we have the cross rent.
Yes.
Note number 5, Kwanza. 5, 5, that. 55, 36.4. Then we less allowable expenses. Allowable expenses to kona nini? To kona expenses. 84.4. 84.6. We have the IPD. The cost of 6.4 million still. So can we have 10% of 6.4 million? I just to note number 5, that is 640. 640. That is an expense. Before deducting capital allowances and also deducting expenses. So expenses are 84,600. So you need to get the capital allowances. So they did not deduct two items. One of the items was capital allowances, and another item was expenses amounting to 84,600. The net is how much? Sorry, 11.8. Yeah, we have other rental income. Can we make that one to the residential? 11 rental income, we go for you. Can make it residential to make our life easier. Then we have investment income. They have not told us anything about investment income apart from the note number 3. So in investment income, we can put what? We can put cash. Sorry? Because we have not been told whether it is qualifying or non-qualifying, so we're just making our life easier. Okay, assume non-qualifying, then check the total investment income per the joint work. Total investment income is how much? 18.4.3. Then you take the 18,24,300, subtract the note number 3. The new balance in a bank, you can assume not qualifying. Kama unapenda kazi mingi. Yeah, you can assume qualifying or exempt. Mafweke dash. So that the total taxable income is quite happy. How much? 6487.64. 6487.64. What of the tax liability? 25% of then we less what? So the relief near me. Yeah, rental. So 10% of how much? 55.36.4. 10% of the gross rent. That's the difference. Yes. 10. That is it.